Hi, this is Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at Inter Arbor Solutions, and you're listening to Briefings Direct. Our next Healthcare Insights discussion explores the shift medical services providers are making to improve the overall patient experience. Taking a page from modern data-driven industries that emphasize consumer satisfaction and ease, a major hospital in the New York metro area has embarked on a journey to transform healthcare as a service. To learn more about the surging importance and relevance for improving patient experiences in the healthcare sector using many tools available to other types of businesses, we are now joined by Laura Semmelies, Vice President of Digital Patient Experience at Northwell Health in Metro New York. We're also here with Julie Gerdeman, President at HealthPay24 in Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania. Welcome to you both. What are the trends that are forcing, I guess we could call a makeover, in this idea of patient experience, even more consumer-centric patient experience, Laura?
So I would say the number one trend we're watching is actually the trend of the patient as consumer. Not all health systems are even calling patients consumers just yet, and that is truly critical. You know, we, in our organization, we like to look at Jeff Bezos's very, very popular comment about customer obsession and not competition obsession. And so if you really truly understand what the patient needs and what the patient wants as a consumer, then you can actually deliver a new experience.
And this is a departure. It really wasn't that long ago where the patient was on the receiving end of information and care and was almost passive, was just off on their way after they received the treatment. Now is almost this need to be proactive, more information, transparency up front. What is it about the need for information that's changed, and why is that the case?
Well, I think a lot of it is what patients are experiencing in other industries, and they're bringing those expectations to healthcare. I think the reality is fundamentally every industry around just has changed over the course of the last decade. And patients are bringing those changes and expectations into healthcare. And in the digital world, patients expect their data is out there, and they know their data is out there, and they expect us to be using it to have more transparent, more personalized, more curated experiences. And in healthcare, we haven't figured out how to do that just yet. And that's truly what digital transformation in healthcare is going to mean. How do you take information, translate it into more meaningful, personalized, and truly get to the point where patients can have experiences that actually drive better clinical outcomes?
And is that because this is more of a marketplace? Do you feel like you're in competition, that other providers of healthcare could come in with a better patient experience, and therefore the patients would say, I'm going there?
For sure. I don't know that that's true in every market, but certainly in the market that I operate, we live in a very competitive market in New York. And the reality is if a patient is not getting the experience they want, they have choices and they will opt for those choices. I think there was a study recently done that said this will be the year that patients will choose who is going to render their care from a patient perspective based on things that they do or do not have. Whether those things can range from the ability to book appointments online, the ability to have virtual visits, to the access to a patient portal with medical record information, or all of the above. And depending on who that patient you're interacting with, those patients are going to be making choices tomorrow. And if you don't have these capabilities, if you don't have the interest to treat the patient and their needs, you won't get that patient in tomorrow's state.
All right, Julie, given that we've seen a transition to the patient experience almost on the same track as retail, where it has to be an awesome experience for them to come back for more or go somewhere else, we're not just talking about healthcare, though. We're also talking about the economics, the finance, maybe upfront information that wasn't there before, proactive thinking. Where do you see that patient experience expanding beyond just healthcare, and why do we need to think about it as a complete experience?
Yeah, I do think Laura's exactly right. The patients are doing so much research up front before you ever interact with them, right? Before they even call and book an appointment, they are doing research. They, 70% actually the time they spend is before they ever book something online or make a phone call. And then it is a complete experience. So everything from that research through the clinical experience and then including the financial and billing experience end to end. So from pre-service through post-service, and that financial experience needs to be at or better the level of experience they had clinically. So they are judging that experience from end to end, and it is competitive. So to Laura's point, it is very competitive. We hear from providers that they want to keep patients out of their competitors' waiting room. And part of that is driving an experience where the consumer, patient, is informed, engaged, and engaged throughout the process. So financially speaking, what does that mean? That means digital engagement, something simple and beautiful and mobile, that's email or text, you know, meet the consumer when they are, whenever they are, wherever they are, whether it's in the evening or early in the morning on their devices. That's how people live today. Those personalized, curated experience. It's something, you know, they wake up and say, okay, Google or Alexa, they want that same experience in healthcare.
You don't want to walk into a time machine where you're going back 30 or 40 years just because you go to the hospital, right? You think the same experience should exist that you get in your living room when you go to see your doctor and get care. Laura, when we think about patient-centric care, it's complicated enough trying to understand the medical issues. But now there's this added level of complexity about the finances, co-pays, deductibles, certain kinds of insurance, supplemental insurance, upfront estimates versus who knows what the bill is going to be 6 months from now when this is all over. How do we transcend the need for patient-centric with the understanding that it's very complex and these people probably need some tender, loving care and understanding these complex financial issues?
So I think a couple of things. One, segmenting the patients as far as who they are at that moment. And we know that patients can move very, very quickly from a very healthy sort of wellness state into a state that is more of a chronic disease management or into an episode where they need a period of very intense care in and out of hospital, at home, and so on and so forth. And so understanding first where all of your pain points are as far with patients and where patients' pain points are in those different patient journeys is first and foremost. Second is starting to understand your data and do look back analysis to understand what those ranges of responsibility look like and how do you start to articulate and package those things so you have more norms that you can start to do early financial counseling around. And then the final part of that is being able to communicate as things are changing in a person's course of treatment, that something has in fact changed and that it has an impact on your financial responsibility. That kind of dialogue in our industry is almost non-existent right now. And patients are, you know, the first thing they're looking for is trying to do searches by who their insurance is. Well, insurance isn't enough. It's not enough to know that I'm going to see Dr. So-and-so for X with insurance plan B. You need to know far more than that to really get an accurate sense of what's going on. So our job is to figure out how to do that for patients. Do I have a script? No. And would that script be the same for you and for Julie? Absolutely not. So we have to get really, really good at figuring out how do we get to the right level of detail of information about you and what you're seeking and enough about what we know about our health system and what our costs are and what the options are so that we can engage in a dialogue. It could be a digital dialogue, but we have to get engaged in a dialogue. And the reality is we know even in a digital situation, patients only want to share a certain amount of information, but they want accurate information. So what's that balance? How do you achieve that? And I think that that's what the next year to year and a half is going to be about figuring out. Transparency isn't posting a set of charges. It's just not. And I think it's a step in the right direction, similar to what meaningful use was, that there's a mandate out there saying that transparency is important. And we all agree with that. But what gives you meaningful transparency and the ability to actually start to control your options and make decisions that have association with a patient's financial health goals too.
So the right information to the right person in the right context at the right time. Well, to me, what that means is a conversation that's based on shared data, because without data along the way, you can't get the context, the timing. And so what is it about a data story behind this patient-centric story that we might need to flesh out?
So one thing I would say is there's collaboration in there. If we look at the back end of the journey, one of the biggest problems right now is explanation of benefits and a statement. They don't say the same thing, and they're coming from two different places. And it's very hard even on that at that juncture to explain to a patient as a health system when you don't have that explanation of benefits in front of you or that EMB and EOB in front of you. So what I think we're going to see a lot of in this next set of months and years is collaboration between payers and health systems and hopefully a new standard around how do we communicate about around the back end. But then that will, again, start to come to the front, because we can't independently dialogue with a patient about their responsibility. We don't own the benefit structure, and there's a lot of moving parts in there. And so to independently try to control that conversation as a health system, we couldn't possibly get it right. So one of the strategies we're using is how do we work with each and every one of our health systems to try and drive some innovation around data sharing and collaboration so that we can get to the right answer for a shared patient. That consumer is shared between both ourselves as well as the payer plan that hosts that patient. And then you add one layer of extra complexity around the employer population. And those three players really need to be working very carefully together to be able to answer this problem. It's not going to be a single conversation.
So this idea of shared collaborative data transfer across multiple organizations that really didn't open their boundaries before, kind of a big problem. Julie, how do you see this customer-centric data equation playing out?
I think actually technology and innovation is really going to drive the future of this. So it's truly an opportunity for companies to come together. And when I say that, I mean interoperability, whether you're a payments provider like HealthPay, or you're providing statement information, you're providing estimate information. So the way that we look at it is across all of those fronts. All of that data relates to that one patient and how technology and how we innovate can really help solve for it. We view interoperability as the key, and we actually hear it all the time. So Northwell and a lot of our other provider customers are asking for that transparency and interoperability because they have, you know, 22 back-end systems in the organization that we, as part of that community, need to be interoperable and integrate with to then present that data in a simple way that a consumer can understand. Because when you're a consumer, you just want the information that you need at that moment to make a decision. If you can get it proactively, all the better. And then also underlying all of this, though, I still feel is trust. It's something I like to talk about, is that transparency is needed because there's a lack of trust. So if there's actually trust, then that transparency is just part of the trust equation. So you present transparency, you do it consistently, then the consumer and the patient has trust, right? They walk in, there is an immediate trust when you walk into a provider, into a doctor's office, as a patient, as a parent. And that technology, I think, has an opportunity to really help solve for some of that.
So Laura, you all are the intercept point with the patient. They're going to be asking you the questions. You're going to have to collect from them. They have to, in a sense, look to you to be the funnel into this large ecosystem behind the scenes. What would you like to see more of from those other players in that ecosystem to make your job easier so that you can actually provide that right level of care up front to the patient?
Yeah, so I think collaboration and interoperability in this space is essential. And I think I definitely think we need to see more of that. I think the other thing that we need, and it's not necessarily from those players, but from a collective whole, is a sense of modeling if-then situations. If this happens, what will happen? And leveraging from other components where we model things out really, really well and in a very sophisticated fashion. For whatever reason, in an area with so many choices and paths that you could take, we don't do any of that in pricing transparency with our patients. And I really think we need to, because the boundaries are not tight. You can change from a $20, you know, copay to co-insurance just at the, you know, and a percentage of your overall charges with one simple thing, whether you're moving from observation to inpatient or inpatient back to observation. And it changes the whole balance card for a patient. And having the ability to model that out and articulate the why and the how and the when and what its impact is, it's a very complicated conversation, but we need to figure out how to, A, what are all of those options and what are all of those drivers of cost, and then make it simple so that patients can engage with it, understand it, anticipate, and then ultimately be able to hold their responsibility. Look, most patients, you know, I hear oftentimes that patients are slow to pay or they struggle to pay, all of these things. I don't think that they're untrue, but I think part of what makes it slow to pay is just the confusion and complexity around this information. I don't think any patient doesn't want to hold their health system or their provider accountable for their services without rendering their share. It's just the complexity around this that makes it difficult and creates a friction point that just shouldn't be there. And we do have a trust situation from an administrative perspective. I don't think our patients trust us in regards to the cost of their care, to what their share of the care is. I don't think they trust their payers tremendously. And so we have to earn trust first. And by earning trust, it's going to be It's going to mean we need to be way more accurate and way more upfront and hold that. So some of this is going to be just about nailing on the basics. Did you give me a bill that I could understand? Could I pay it? And did I have options when I went to pay it? And then we can back up and do the sexier stuff. But the sexier stuff, you know, we don't even do that easy stuff well today. You know, I used to joke as we put in our new online payment portal, I used to say, you know, in some regards, we should be paying patients to pay us at this point because we've made it that difficult. And now I think we're in a better place where we're putting in the foundation so that we can earn some trust and credibility. And we're starting the dialogue of what do you need, patient, so that we can go back and create those tools. And we're going to engage those patients. We've done over 1,000 hours alone just in financial health of patient focus group studies, user testing, to understand what they need to feel better about their financial health. There's clinical health, there's clinical outcomes, but there's also financial health. And those are new words to the industry. Those are new words to us. What it's going to become, if I had a crystal ball, I think it's really going to be a net new conversation around what a patient needs to feel secure and to feel like they understood what they were getting into and that they have the ability to pay it and that they had options to.
Julie.
2 points that Laura made there I think are really important. The first is around learning and testing and modeling. So we're really looking at the space differently, meaning what sort of predictive analytics can we use upfront in very specific use cases to actually solve for that piece of anticipation, right? What do they need? What works? So we've isolated specific use cases and test, you know, using technology to test and learn. An example of that would be like discounts. So should you offer an upfront discount for a patient to pay? You know, if they pay in full, they get a discount. And there, you know, what we've learned is there are certain cases where you can actually collect more, even though you think by offering a discount that you'd collect less, you end up offering more. So that's one use case, but that predictive analytics, that use upfront and testing and learning is key. The second thing she said, which I think is dead on, is around options. Patients really want options. Of course, I'm looking at it from a financial health perspective, but patients want to know, okay, what are my choices? And if you don't, if it's something that's an emergency situation where you don't have the option to research it up front, okay, but then what are my choices after it happens? If I can't pay it up full, which most American consumers have less than $500 set aside for medical expenses, right? All the studies show, can I have the option of a payment, a self-service flexible payment plan? Can I have the option of a loan? What are my choices there that I can make an informed choice at home, at my convenience, and can I self-service it? That's, I think, 2 key points and 2 examples where technology can really help play a role in the future.
You really can't separate the economics and the healthcare. And if we ever could, it probably wasn't a good idea in the first place. So we're at a new age. We're in a new era where economics, healthcare blend together, decision-making comes together. We talked about the need for data. And while data coming together can help with collaboration and process efficiency, it also puts you in a position to be able to look at that data and apply analytics and learn from it and then apply those lessons back. So a really exciting time. But I want to pause for a second. Laura, your title of Vice President of Digital Patient Experience is a little bit unique. What background do you have and what does it take to become a Vice President of Digital Patient Experience?
That is a great question. The Digital Patient Experience Office at Northwell is a net new organization inside of the health system, a new division, if you will. And it's not an initiative or a program focused office where it expects to be one and done. You go in and you deliver something and then you're done. We're really rallying around this notion that the patient expects to be able to interact with us digitally, and we need to change our entire and transform our entire organization culturally, operationally, and technically to be able to accommodate that transformation. And so what I did before, I was responsible for revenue cycle transformation at the health system. So I do have a financial background and I do have a background inside this space specifically. However, what set me up for this digital transformation was really the notion that self-service was going to disrupt the revenue cycle and that we needed to have capability around self-service, which inherently puts you in what does the consumer want and need to manage their administrative interactions differently with the health system. I was the constant voice for the last decade at our health system saying we need to do this to our infrastructure so that we can be and able to do this. And this in that case was really to rationalize and standardize our core applications that serve the patient, i.e. revenue cycle systems, so that we could then interoperate in a very different way and create a platform by which patients could self-serve. And, you know, we're still in that journey. But we're at a point in the journey where we can start to engage very differently. So what am I trying to solve in the first version of digital? Really, three fundamental questions, and it's all driving at the primary pain points or friction points that patients are having. You never remember who I am. I've been coming here for the last 10 years, and you still ask me for my name, my date of birth, my insurance, my clinical history. You should know that by now. Two, I can't figure out how to get in to see the right doctor at the right time, at the right location for me. Maybe a great location for you or a great appointment for you, but what if it doesn't work for me? How do I fix that? And then the third is my bills are confusing and the whole process of actually trying to pay one or get a question answered is infuriating. So those are the three. When you talk to anyone in our health system, whether it's our chief patient experience officer or a CEO or a chief administrative officer or COO, these are the things that were coming out of customer surveys, press gaining results, complaints. When you had direct conversations with patients, when we're talking to our patient family advisory councils, it wasn't the clinical stuff. It was all of this administrative burden that we were putting on patients and this anonymity that patients were walking through our halls with that we needed to focus on first. And so that's what we're doing. And we will be bringing to bear a set of tools that patients that are just that, tools that patients will be able to use in a very systematic way to help negotiate appointment management, viewing and managing their appointments online with the ability to book, change, cancel, anything they need to do, as well as just simply see those appointments and get directions to those appointments and communicate with those administrative offices. The second piece of this is around the you never remember who I am. You've been to the doctor. You've seen the clipboard, the same blank packet of information, regardless of whether you were there yesterday and you see a new doctor, you're getting that same blank clipboard. So one of the things we're focusing on is how do we get away from the clipboard, remember information, and seek information twice, only if there's the potential for that information to have changed. And then giving it back to the patient in not a blank format, but with any presenting them with anything we already know about you and giving them the opportunity to revise and to do that, not when they get to the practice, but doing it remotely on their time so that we're respecting them and having them truly prepared when they come into the office. The other side of never remembering who I am is really about authentication and digital identity and attaching not just a name with a face virtually, but also being able to authenticate you so that we can share information with you at home that's meaningful and have digital interactions that are not so superficial that they're not next generation. And then the third piece was the online payment portal, which we are in fact using HealthPay 24 for that. And the vision there is to be able to have a patient not only be able to pay a single bill, but if you have a responsibility to our health system across the entire scope of our health system, whether it's lab, ambulance, hospital or physician, that you have the ability to pay that in a single transaction on our digital tools. But go take one step further. Give it a retail experience. Save the card on file. If you paid a bill last week, you shouldn't have to rekey that digit into the system. Rekey those digits into the system. Take it another step further. If you have options to pay, whether it's a loan, a payment plan, or simply the ability to use Apple Pay or Google Pay or any of the connect to Venmo, these are the things we're talking about in that space. But again, those are what we really believe are table stakes and we're behind in, and we're putting in those pieces just to catch up. But I think our vision is far deeper than that in financial health to back up all the way to the point of I've got a patient who's looking to seek care. How do I help them understand what their financial responsibility and options are at that point before they've even gotten to the point where they have a bill in our system? So that's the early version of digital transformation.
You know, everything Laura just talked about comes down to one word, and it's loyalty. What they're putting in place will drive patient loyalty, consumer loyalty. And in the retail space, right, we see it all the time. We are loyal to certain brands because of how we interact with them, or at least we feel like we're interacting with them, that emotional experience. So it's a combination of the human and the technology to create the raving fans, in this case, raving fans of Northwell.
Now, we've seen the portal approach be very powerful in other industries. So when I go to my bank these days, I can see all my transactions. I know what my balances are. I can even set up payment schedules. If I go to my investment organization, I can see the same thing with my retirement funds. If I go to my mortgage holder, same thing. I can see what I own on my house. Maybe I have a second property that I want to get a new loan on. It's all there. So we know that this can be done. Julie, what needs to happen in order to get that level of sort of portal transparency and give the power to the consumer to make good choices into the healthcare sector?
I think it's a couple things. I think it is a forward-looking view into what's possible. And we're seeing we're seeing disruption. I mean, we're here at HIMSS, right? We're here at the gathering of 45,000 people in Orlando who are thinking, who are champions of healthcare, right? Thinking about what can be and what's possible. So to me, that's where you start. Like Laura said, you know, we're playing catch up, but we also need to be leapfrogging into the future. And so what is it in terms of emerging technology, perhaps, that could change the dynamic? AI, what's happening there? How could it be leveraged? The predictive analytics that I mentioned, or blockchain in the distributed ledger, what role can that play? So I am really excited about what's possible with marrying emerging technology while still solving for the nuts and bolts of interoperability, integration, because there's hard work there in the integration and interoperability of systems talking to another. So you can't get away from the ugly part of the job, but then there's an exciting future part of the job that I think is really fundamental. And the last thing I'll say is around, Laura talked about on the panel, she talked about culture and cultural shift. And none of it could happen without an embracing of change management. That's also hard because they're people and personalities, but that if you can embrace change management along with the technology disruption, then that's where it can happen.
Right. So just to play off of one of the points that Julie made, you know, the hard, dirty work behind the scenes and the data work is really fundamentally, I think, what has prevented healthcare from really getting into this space. When we talk about digital, people are represented by their data in the digital space, and you only know people when you understand their data. And I think in healthcare, at least from a provider perspective, we've really been pretty good about collecting information about a patient's clinical record, right? We understand them clinically. We also do a pretty decent job at understanding the patient from a reimbursement and charges perspective so that we can get a bill out the door and get the bill paid. Some would argue that we don't get the bill paid when it gets down to the secondary responsibility of the patient very well, but fundamentally we do collect that information and we get those bills out and there is interaction there. What we don't do well is there are hundreds of systems, literally hundreds of systems in any big health system today. The bridges and connections between those data systems are just not there. And so when the patient sits in between all the patient interacts with each and every one of them. I am patient as mom of three kids. I am patient as daughter of two aging parents. I am wife to husband who I'm interacting with, and I'm my own self, my patient. The data that I need to deal with and the systems I need to interact with when I'm booking an appointment versus paying a bill versus looking for lab results versus trying to, I don't know, look for a growth chart on a child that somebody wants. I'm left to self-navigate this world of very complexly that I don't understand as a patient. And our job to figure out how to really manage tomorrow and the patient of tomorrow who wants to interact digitally is going to have to be to integrate all of those different data points and make it universally acceptable. And EMRs really were more dealing with that the EMR portals were really more dealing with just that clinical interaction. Some have gotten good at doing some of the administrative components, but certainly not all of them. And so creating something net new that is far more broader and has the ability to connect data points that are there, but just live in silos today, both operationally as well as technically, is going to be the mandate.
You don't necessarily build trust when you're asking the patient to be the middleware, to be the sneakerware walking between the PC and the mainframe. And that's what we're doing. All right, let's talk about some examples, because in order to get cultural change, one of the tried and true methods is to show initial progress, have a success story that you can champion that then leads to adoption and so forth. So I heard about your digital front door team. That seems to me an example of something that maybe works. It could be a harbinger of larger cultural shift. Tell me about it.
Yeah, so our digital front door team is responsible for creating tools and technology and a single access point for our patients so that when they get in, they won't have to have multiple passwords or multiple journeys in order to interact with us. And so over the course of the last year, we've established what I would refer to as a digital platform that all of our digital technologies and our personal and our human touch will connect to. And that last point is really important because I think when a patient interacts with you digitally, there is a core expectation to today, that if they've told you something digitally, as soon as they show up in person, you're going to know it and use it and remember it and just extend the conversation or extend the journey of experience as opposed to start over. And that was really critical to our platform. So all of the integration behind the scenes, as well as making sure that if they gave us something, we actually consumed it and used it. So to give you a real legitimate example of what that looks like, a single sign-on capability, an API management tool, a customer relationship management database, where we we can learn all of the information about a patient that's actually going to drive different kinds of experiences that can personalize and curate. That data lives in the middle of those two data topics that we were talking about earlier. We don't collect that today. And if we do, it's because I've got a really good nurse or I've got a really good patient access ambassador who is learning something, but they have no means to share it with the next employer, the next employer, the next employee. So we had to put in a customer relationship management tool that kind of brokers all of this and is in the hands of every employee in the health system. And then the last piece was then to start taking that and start putting meaningful tools around the things, the friction points we talked about. So put in an appointment management capability so that doctors and we can book directly into, see availability of a provider and book appointments directly into it with no middleman. I'm not having somebody call back a resource because I saw you requested an appointment online. No, this is direct booking. Just like when I book an appointment for on OpenTable, I will have that appointment. I'm going to show up at the restaurant. Nobody's calling me back. They may send me a digital reminder, but they're not calling me back to say, what time did you actually want to come to see? I already gave you that. So that's an example of.
And how has the digital front door team worked out? Do you have any metrics, any measurement? What's the success?
We are net new. We took a very agile approach to implementing this thing. Some of the capabilities, we didn't even have a resident in the health system. So our very first component of this was putting in the online payment center with HealthPay 24. We did that in July of 2018. So we've got approximately $25 million collected now and over 46,000 transactions at this point, just in the last 6 months. In December, we actually attached the sign-in to that, which means it's no longer a one-by-one statement payment process. It's now you have the opportunity to log in and see all of your balances across Northwell. We've already had 3,000 people in just a little over a month sign in to that process, and we're starting to see evidence that our collections are starting to go up. I'm not really ready to share that quite yet statistically, but we're already starting to see that evidence. We implemented our digital forms tool in a point of service mechanism back in September. We've collected over 14,000 digital forms at this point. Patients are loving that capability, and the next version will be an at-home version. So you'll get a text message saying, we see you've booked an appointment. Here are your forms that are in order to prepare for your visit. They'll get them online. And then we also are piloting biometrics so that when you first show up at your appointment, you will have the opportunity to have your picture taken. It's an iris scanning and deep facial recognition technology, and that'll be a method of authentication that we'll be using to eventually get to selfie check-ins, eventually use to be able to access your ultimate portal. The intent here was to deploy as early as there was value to the patient, and then all of those things will be connected as a single experience by the end of this quarter. So what's still to come? The appointment management and the ability to book your appointments online, change, manage, see all your appointments, as well as the at-home experience on visits and a connection to our patient portal, because we already have a patient portal and we didn't want that population to be left out on their side. So all of those connection points will be rendered through the same single sign-in by the end of this quarter, both on our website as a channel. So northwell.edu, it will be Northwell Online. We're not branding it separately. Northwell.edu, you can access any one of these things and be remembered when you come back, as well as a proprietary app that will come out in the App Store.
So it sounds like those metrics and that adoption uptake very quickly are showing that a good customer experience, patient experience, isn't just good for the patient, it's good for the provider. It's good for the entire process. Julie, it sounds like Northwell Health is on the cutting edge. How unique is this sort of digital front door approach?
Yeah, we are seeing more and more providers adopt this approach, this one point of access into their system, right? Whether you're find a doctor or pay your bill. We have seen in our studies that 7 out of 10 patients, the only reason they actually go to a provider's website is to pay a bill. So it's one of the main reasons. So from a financial perspective, we're really working hard to work with leaders like Laura. These are new roles. They're emerging in the different health systems across the country, these digital patient experience. And that creating that experience does drive adoption, right? And that adoption drives collection.
And I will say, you know, this channel, while extremely important to us from a patient loyalty and retention perspective, that's our opportunity to say, we've heard you. We have an obligation to provide you tools that are convenient, easy to use, and quite frankly, delight you, surprise and delight you. But that is not the only channel. We recognize that we have to be in lots of different places from a find a doc perspective, because to Julie's point, that is not the place every patient is going. And so there will be opportunities for us to populate what I refer to as the book now button. My book now button cannot be exclusive to the Northwell digital front door. I need to have that book now button in the hands of every payer agent who's on the phone talking to a patient or in their digital channel and their membership log, ready to book appointments with me. I need to have it out in the ZocDocs of the world and any other open scheduling application that's out there. I need to have ratings, reviews out. Like, we need to be multi-channel in our funnel in, but once we get you in, we've got to give you those tools and those resources to surprise and delight you and make that re-engagement with somebody else harder, because we make it so easy for you to see our health system, and we have something that's portable so you could take it with you if you need to go somewhere else. But the concept is we really want to be full service, and we really want to give you all of the tools so that you can be happy about the service that you're giving, not just the clinical outcome, but the administrative service.
It really sounds like Northwell is differentiating itself by this customer-centric focus. I guess it's important then for customers, for patients, to maybe devote with their spend, with their health care provider choices. So maybe be a little bit choosy. Look around. If you do have choice, make the right choice. This will further instigate more change in the culture and the overall adoption. I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. You've been listening to a sponsored Briefings Direct Healthcare Insights discussion exploring the shift medical services providers are making to improve the overall patient experience in the healthcare sector. And we have learned how improving patient experiences will increasingly rely on the many tools available to other types of businesses. So please join me now in thanking our guests, Laura Semles, Vice President of Digital Patient Experience at Northwell Health in Metro New York, and Julie Gerderman, President at HealthPay 24 in Mechanicsburg, Pennsylvania. And a big thanks as well to our audience for joining this HealthPay 24 sponsored thought leadership discussion. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at InterArbor Solutions, your host and moderator. Thanks again for listening, and do come back next time.